Ladies and gentlemen, the house is now open for tonight's performance of Trevor Goose and his Dark Night of Life. Please take your seats. Thank you very much.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we are very proud to present to you a Christmas story. A story of a little impoverished, defenseless girl who on Christmas Eve night goes out into the freezing cold to sell some matches and then dies. Yeah, that's pretty much the gist of it. Not very Christmassy. Bleak, some might say. And we can leave it at that. But on the way, this little girl has a truly remarkable vision. a vision so extraordinary that it truly makes up for the painful emotional mangle that we're about to put you through. But hold hard, I hear you ask. Who is this man with a mangle promising pain? Allow me to introduce myself. Your storyteller for tonight, a man some people call Hans Christian. I was born in a dance in Denmark near the shrine of King Canute. I had no brothers or sisters, so I made some out of wood. I have them with me in my pockets, they help to keep me sane. Except I've lost them. So the night is full of grief and rage and pain. An early setback, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hope I can last the hour on medication alone. At 11 I was orphaned and I had to learn a trade. I was a tailor, then a weaver, then a cigarette manufacturer. It was here I got a cough which got rougher and then fiercer. But while wheezing, my lungs bleeding, I would dream of the theatre. So here I am before you, that little orphan boy. I say orphan. Technically, my mother is still alive, but she hasn't been to see a show for quite a while, so you know, she's dead to me. The band. On accordion. On accordion, we have Greta Garden. Garden in Danish means street, which is where I found her, as it happens. No need to feel sorry for her. She's just glad to be inside. On clarinet, we have Brigitte Luxmore. Now, last time, I gave out a bit too much information on Brigitte. Someone was able to steal her identity, so there's no going back to the Halle Orchestra for her. On drums, we have Herr Grün. He won't tell me any more than that. On piano, we have Fingers Nisbet. Alarmingly, he got that nickname before he learned the piano. Together, we are Denmark's finest tribute band. Hans Christian und the Andersons. Joining us tonight is a girl with the voice and the harp of an angel.
All right.
She's been with us since the start, found abandoned after we did a gig in Cardiff, and brought up by the family Anderson as though she were one of our own. Which, of course, she might be. We've all had a number of lost days in our careers. Hey, Brigitte. Allow me to present to you the one and only Ingrid Anderson.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And could I say, if there is anyone in tonight who did happen to leave a small child in Cardiff by the castle in the mid-80s, could you let one of the stewards know? Thank you.
It only gets sadder. To begin our Christmas story, let me transport you to the streets of Odense, Denmark. It is Christmas Eve, normally a twinkling, joyous occasion. Glühwein, mulling, herring, pickling, a bratwurst poking out of every doorway. But such delicacies were denied one poor child For her, the night contained nothing but the bleak and empty darkness of despair. Breaks your heart, doesn't it, ladies and gentlemen? And in the pocket of her old apron, there were boxes of matches for sale. But no one had bought anything off her the whole day, nor had anyone given her a penny out of pity. Not one penny. No pity. So, shivering with cold and hunger, she crept along, the poor child, the snowflakes settling on her dark, her black hair. Lights were shining from every window, and as it was Christmas Eve, there was a savoury smell, some might say an overwhelming smell, of roast goose. Goose. That Christmas Eve night, the streets of Odense were dense with goose. Can you smell it? Is it done yet? The smell captured the little match seller. And in a corner where one house butted up against another and where the smell of the goose was strongest, most eye-watering, she stopped. She sank down. She drew her little feet under her. A picture of abject hardship. Sorry. Oh, sorry, ladies and gentlemen. I can relate to this, ladies and gentlemen.
Are we stopping then?
Just a minute. Take a random stroll through the streets of Odense, and you might well stumble across me, huddled up just like this wretched match seller. Propped up against the tomb of Saint Canute, reliving the horrors of my sickly youth. The horrors of my ambiguous adolescence. The horrors of my entire adult life, actually. Poor Hans Christian. It's no wonder I write these grim little tales. A sensitive, poetic boy, I'd flick my feverish curls and toy with notions of some clear blue weather shining on a boy who's never.
Never go home empty-handed. A murderous father has demanded a penny a match, but I've got nothing. A furious mother, her slipper's missing.
Missing my time, a school too hasty to beat this Dane into a pastry. A bleaker boy you could not mould into a happier creature cold.
So cold right here and cold at home, the roof through which the wind blows so. The rats and straw repair the most part, but the snow falls on us both with
both miserable, but I'm much more so. I'm much more so. Miserable me. You see us both here looking glum, but of us glum ones I'm more glum. More down am I, and more dejected. Dismal low, and fed up wretched. Depressed, despondent, both are gloomy. The one who's sadder, though, that would be me. That would be me.
Me it would be. I am sadder.
She is less so.
She is less so.
She is less so. Let's call it 50-50, ladies and gents. And in this near incomparable state of depression, the little match girl thinks to herself,
perhaps I can delve into my merchandise just this once, as a burning flame might give me some comfort.
And there, in the heart of Odense's Welsh quarter, she takes out a match from her bundle and strikes it against the wall to see if its short flame might warm her fingers. There! How it spluttered as it burnt. It gave a, a soft, bright light, like a little candle. And she held her hand over it to protect it from the wind.
Oh, wonderful light, flickering, phosphorus and warm, burning, heat from the fire, warming, shadows on my hand, dancing, my head or the light, I can't be sure, but the bricks seem to melt and dissolve the wall. Inside I can see a kitchen of brass, a kettle, a pot, and a cup of tea. A large iron stove cooking, a pile of
thus, she could see straight through the wall and into the kitchen. And it was so real for the child that she stretched out her little feet to warm them at the big brass stove. But lo, the light died.
Ow!
The stove vanished, and she had only the remains of a half-burnt match in her hand.
Bugger!
Bugger indeed. Speaking of which, Hans Christian Andersen wrote the story of the little match girl in 1848 when he was in England, staying with Charles Dickens. It was a 5-week stay. 5 weeks. He couldn't get rid of him. In the end, Dickens shouted at him in frustration, "Get out of my house, you bony bugger!" That's a true story. I don't think we should judge Hans too harshly, though. I mean, we've all been thrown out of our houses once or twice in our lives, haven't we, ladies and gents? Haven't we? Well, I know I have. Hey, all of us in the band have. It's the life of a player. It's a family breaker. Of course, there are those of us who were thrown out before we had words to complain about it.
24 I am. Blood type O. Birthmark on my shoulder. I'm a lifelong supporter of Cardiff Rugby Club. Yeah?
Yeah? Anyway. No point in dwelling on personal circumstances. Hey, we've got a cracking number coming up, a real crowd pleaser. Inspired by the vision of the stove through the wall and eager to see more, the little match girl reached into her old apron pocket and with a half-numb finger she pulled out another match to strike it against the wall. As it burst into flame, its light fell on the wall, which became as transparent as a veil, and she could see into the room. This time, she saw a table, covered with a snowy white tablecloth, and on it a splendid dinner service, and stuffed with apples and dried plums, and steaming majestically, there was a magnificent roast goose.
Yes, a goose. Is it real or is it a vision? See, long
7 months, each day, each hour, I've had this hunch that a diet of beer and bread and sugar and schnitzel and figs and cream and butter and dates and plums and corn and lard and Goose and sweet and bread and starch and liver and oil and coffee and cheese would give me type 2 diabetes. And I am so incredibly fat that you, little girl, are thinking that
I want a slice of this. I want a piece of him. This Goose is very greasy and I want it dribbling on me. Just a slice of this. Give me a piece of him. I want to stab him with a knife. I want to eat his fatty
mouth. She wants a slice of this.
I want a piece of him. This Goose is quite annoying and I want it dribbling on me.
Just a slice of this. Give her a piece of him. She wants to stab him with a knife. She wants to eat his fatty knife. But oh, little girl, your match burns fast. Each flicker, each flame, it will not last. And a Goose who can sing and can also dance will soon be carved and forked and lanced by Gerd and Gustav and Dieter and Dirk, by Hilda and Helga and Jorgen and Jörg, by Gerda and Gans and Dieter and Dirk, and Otto and Olaf and Klaus and Kurt. And you will reach for the plate and wish you had a family who could give you this.
I want a slice of this. Give me a piece of him. This Goose is very greasy and I want it dribbling on. Just a slice of this. Give me a piece of him. I want to stab him with a knife. I want to eat his fatty life.
She wants a slice of this. She wants a piece of him. This Goose is quite an oiler and she wants it dribbling on. Give her a piece of him. She wants to stab him with a knife. She wants to beat his fatty life. And wurst and sweets and cheese and eggs and liver and onion and pork and peas.
And chips and cake and rum and coke.
And dates and plums and ice cream floats.
And pie and mash
and corned beef hash
and milk and stout
and sauerkraut.
You are so warm and fat.
You want a piece of that.
I want to stab him with a knife. I want to eat his fatty life.
Oh God, she got me good then. Okay, good. So that is that. And okay, so what happens is that then the light burns out and the Goose disappears and she's left with the old black wall in front of her and all that stuff. Okay, but we're going to keep the Goose with us for a little bit longer.
Oh, for God's sake!
Well, you say, oh, for God's sake, but it was a condition of your generous gentlemanship that I get to speak a little bit, all right? All right, okay, so ladies and gentlemen, this is now like a kind of a sort of interval for the band and all that, but also, if you have ordered some drinks at the bar, you know, they're going to be brought to your place here, so you don't even have to, get up unless you want to do like a little pitch or something like that. Okay, so my name is Trevor Nielsen, and as well as having the privilege of playing the part of Mr. Goose tonight, I am also the Deputy Tourist Officer for Odense in Denmark. I am very keen that you shouldn't all go away today with the impression that Odense is a city where little girls are put onto the streets, yeah, and forced to work in conditions which are in direct contravention of EU regulations of health and safety in the workplace, you know. Something that we in Denmark are absolutely passionate about, all right? So if you'll permit a little PR on behalf of Odense, then we can get back to Mr. Anderson's fictional little story, all right? Okay, so this is Odense, on the west of Denmark. Home of Hans Christian Andersen and capital of the island of Funen. It is home to 152,000 inhabitants, which makes it the third most largest city in Denmark after Copenhagen and Aarhus. Okay, good. So, this is the Odin Tower. Yes, you like it? Built in 1935 and at the time surpassed only in height by the Eiffel Tower. This one is only 2 feet tall, actually, as the original was destroyed during the Second World War. So, you know, we very much feel Coventry's pain about all that stuff, right? Which is why, you know, for this and for many other reasons, we would very much like to twin with you. Yes? I know Coventry likes the twinning. And I've noticed very many great similarities between our two cities, all right? So first, athletics. Yeah, okay, you know what? This is Louise Ornstedt, yeah? Odense is the home of Louise Ornstedt, who won a gold medal at the European Championships, you know, in backstroke and also butterfly, I think. Yeah, she's a really great swimmer. Okay, so we have her, and you have got Marlon Devenish in Coventry's Marlon Devenish. He won a medal at the same championships. Okay. Not gold. But he really is, you know, despite that, super fast. Okay, so celebrity. Odense is the home of Ove Wendelbrosbrook Pettersen, who is the star of Huset Par Christianshavn. Yes, you know it? Huset Par Christianshavn. Yeah, it's a really funny Danish sitcom. Yeah, do you have it? It's like two guys with a broom, you know it? Yeah, it's, yeah, okay, yeah. It's really funny. I'm surprised it hasn't come over here yet. Okay, so we have him, and you have got, I think, Clive Owen. You have Clive Owen. And we, in Coventry, yeah, we get the Chancellor in Denmark. Over there, it's called Den Meneske Den Hendels. My wife, she really loves it. She wanted to come over here, actually, to meet Clive Owen, who lives in Spon End. Is that right? Yeah? Yes, the nice bit, is it? Yeah, with the big houses. Okay, yeah, I understand. Okay, so we have an impersonator of our most famous son, Hans Christian Andersen, who is here tonight in the bar, I think. No! Don't drink the blue stuff. No blue stuff for you, I think. No, and don't give any to Ingrid. I don't want a repeat of, you know, St. Albans. Okay, so we have Hans Christian Andersen, and in Coventry we have...
Hey! Yeah,
okay, you have an impersonator of Lady Godiva. Who, and I would very much like Lady Godiva to meet Hans Christian, you know. I think she could teach him a little bit about professionalism. You know? I think she hardly ever drinks blue stuff. Okay, so what have we got? Yeah, now in Denmark, Odense has helped Denmark to become the happiest, the healthiest, the most secure, the best educated nation with the highest quality of life and the most compassionate welfare system in the world. Okay. Something that we're really proud about, okay? And Coventry has helped the UK to... I'll have to do the next one there. Maybe another one there. Oh, Jesus Christ, what? No, this is really interesting to me, you know? This is like a place on the wall where you can stick the gum, you know? Is this like art or something? Is this like some sort of citizen gum sculpture collaboration or something? Yeah, because, you know, in Odense, we just put our gum in the bin, you know? So boring. Yeah, you know, so I'm thinking that, you know, with ideas like this, cultural ideas, you know, we could continue to be the happiest, healthiest, most secure nation in the entire world. You know, at the moment, we are just twinned with St. Albans, but we are not allowed to go back there anymore, unfortunately. And it's why we now have to have every single show, you know, on the camera. Sort of video evidence or something. That the person here tonight is Jen. That is Jen, yeah. Well, you can clap her, but she works for the St. Albans police, I think. She is undercover, but I think her real name is Jennifer. I think so, you know. You have been rumbled, I think, Jennifer. All right. So, you know, I think we can be a little bit more ambitious than St. Albans, you know, with the, yeah. What with the gum thing and with Clive Owen actually walking down the street saying hello to people, you know. So if, my point is, in all this, that like in Clive Owen's Coventry, it would be extremely unlikely to find a little frozen girl on the street. All right. So, if you will permit, I am now going to sing the Danish national anthem. You know, and so if you could, yes, just show a little bit of respect for that. That would be. And can we have? I was hoping the band might help give this a bit of dignity. You know, but oh, we've got Mr. Green here. Of course, yes, we have to barricade him in now. So he's still here, which is good. Maybe you could play me something on the bass drum with the anthem or something. Oh, he has a xylophone. No, even better. That's good. Okay. Okay, so let's have the Danish national anthem. Yes. Danish singing land med stemmet bete brude na salten yste strand na salten strand did boot gesiege back. Dad, you can sing along if you want. Der het jet gamle Danmark sig jet jufreje sal og sig jufreje la sal. Oh, thank you very much. And to Mr. Green for the
sound. Painful.
Not painful. Important to put Odense's case, I think.
Agonizing.
You are on your last warning. I mean, I've got the swipe cards for the Formula One hotel and you won't get yours, okay?
Trevor, will I get mine?
Will you get your... Well, you have your own accommodation, I think.
I haven't.
I thought you said you were staying with some friends.
No.
Oh.
Can't I stay in the Formula One hotel too?
Well, I only really have swipe cards for me and the band.
What am I supposed to do with that?
Well, I'm sure if you ask somebody, you'll know.
It's freezing out there.
Well, technically, I don't think Coventry is as cold as Odense, as it happens.
Am I on the street, then?
Well, no, not on the street. I've noticed many, you know, attractive, adorned subways, which you could, you know.
Cardiff Castle, ladies and gentlemen. November the 18th, that's right. November the 18th, 1984. I was wrapped in a granny blanket.
Get your blanket for tonight, Ingrid.
Should steal from the Formula One hotel.
I probably wasn't called Ingrid at the time. I maybe didn't have a name at all. But if you're in tonight, ma'am, ma'am, you could change it. I was thinking maybe Mary or Angharad. Angharad means greatly loved one.
Yeah, okay, and we all greatly love you when, you know, you stand on the stage and sing your lovely songs, okay? So maybe we could get back to the story at hand. Okay, good. Okay, so if we remember that she had a match, it burned out, and so the goose, he disappeared.
Once the goose had mercifully vanished, along with the match, there remained nothing but the cold, thick wall before the girl. So, she lit another match. And again, the wall dissolved and she found herself sitting under a beautiful Christmas tree.
A tree so huge, and
Oh.
That's Leo Minor.
Cetus.
The whale.
The dove.
That's Columbus.
Cancer, the crab.
The scale.
That's Libra. The bear I see.
That's Ursa Major.
Pisces.
The fish.
Aquila.
The eagle.
I see Phoenix.
That's the father.
Leo I see.
Play your harp, girl.
In the streets nearby. She was soon lost, and I've got a picture of her. It's a little bit grainy. It was given to me by the security guard who watches over CCTV in Cardiff City Centre. Is this you? Do you recognise her?
Ingrid.
No?
Ingrid.
Do you recognise her? Have you got a birthmark on your shoulder?
Ingrid.
No. Have you got a birthmark on your shoulder? Are you blood type O? No? Are you blood type O? Anyone here? There must be someone
Ingrid,
here. There must be someone
Ingrid,
here who's blood type O.
Leave
there
it.
Must be someone here who's blood
leave
type
it.
O. I'm just
leave
so...
It.
I need
Ingrid.
It. I had a mince pie for her.
No.
So, little match girl took another match, and she lit it, and its light shone around her, and in its brightness she could see her grandmother, clear and shining, yet mild and loving in her appearance.
Mother?
No. Her grandmother, the only one who'd ever truly loved her.
Take me with you. Take me back. I know you'll go away again when the flame burns out. You'll vanish like the warm stove, the roast goose and the twinkling Christmas tree.
So she made haste to light her whole bundle of matches, for she wished to keep her grandmother there. And the matches burned with a light that was brighter than the noonday. And her grandmother had never appeared so large or so beautiful. And she took the little girl in her arms. And they both flew upwards in brightness and in joy, far above the earth.
Finally, here we are up in the sky, wrapped up together, just you and I. Here there is neither the cold nor the pain, nor the hunger or misery. We're free, we're the same.
To fly over
Cardiff.
And in the dawn of morning, there lay the poor little girl with her pale cheeks and her frozen smiling mouth, leaning against the cold, hard wall. She had frozen to death on Christmas Eve. And the Christmas Day sun rose and shone on her little corpse with a bundle of burnt matches in her hand. She tried to warm herself, the people said. But no one imagined what beautiful things she had seen, or into what glory she had entered with her grandmother on Christmas Day.
Bloody hell!
Trevor!
Sorry.
I just see. You have an IKEA? You have the pride Denmark was going to trip in a place that has a stinky Swedish shop. It dominates the whole country. Did Clive Owen open it? Clive Owen opens a Swedish shop.
Trevor.
Oh, no, not again.
Get the stuff.
How does this happen?
Get the
Why do you give
us stuff? Get the stuff!
Play something nice. Play a nice tune for them.
Oh, look, Henry, look. Yes. In a matter of course. All right, then.
Okay. All right, there we go.
All right, all right.
Right,
that's it. She's all right, ladies and gents. She'll be fine.
Oh, I feel a bit sick.
Oh, she's not going to be sick.
I feel a bit sick.
Sit down. Just have a sit down. All right. Hey, do you know how Hans Christian Andersen died? He fell out of bed. Yeah, that's it. Fell out of bloody bed. But shortly before his death, before he fell out, he called a composer friend of his to his bedside and he said, I want to talk to you about the music for my funeral.
What is that?
That's what?
That voice you were doing.
It was a Danish accent. He was Danish. I'm not. I'm trying to do it right. Look, that's how you speak. That's how you speak.
It's not how I speak.
How do you say funeral?
Funeral.
What's it?
I have to apologise for the gross caricature. I have told him about it.
I'm trying to make it real. Please, he's down again. He's down again. All right.
Not
one of them pills. She's all right. She's all right. That's fine.
Shortly before he died, Hans Christian Andersen spoke to a composer about the music for his funeral. He said that most of the people that would be walking after the coffin would be children, so the composer should make the beat quick to keep time with their little steps.
It's so beautiful.
Yeah, I know.
Gets me every single time.
Me too.
I'm so sorry for my words.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry for St. Albans.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, good. Come.
No, I'm not pushing.
Oh, wait. Okay, so maybe we should finish tonight on something, brighter, lighter, something that the little children can dance to, yes?
Ladies and gentlemen, we give you A Dark Night of Lights. We walk behind the coffin, two by two by two, in an orderly crocodile, it's the Danish way, you know. We have to jump and hop, even though our hearts are heavy, it's what he would have wanted, skipping up the cemetery.
Dancing when you're sick, singing when you're lonesome, laughing when you're hurt inside, grinning on your lonesome, giggling when you're lost. Smile at the abyss of Victor's grin upon your face, at your wretchedness.
The Halle Orchestra has called, they've understood their error. Their clarinetist can come back as long as she plays the cello. A house has finally been found for a homeless accordion player. There's just one room she'll have to share with a drunken violent drummer. Dancing when you're sick, singing when you're lonesome, laughing when you're hurt inside, grinning on your lonesome, giggling when you're lost. Smile at the abyss of
upon your face at your wretchedness. I've been glued right to my seat.
Do you have a birthmark?
I don't believe I do.
You recognize this blanket?
Never seen it hitherto.
Is this you on camera?
It's rather hard to say.
Can you play the harp at all?
Never played one to this day.
Do you have blue eyes, mum?
They're sort of browny red. Sheffield born and bred.
No, it's not her. Dancing when you're sick, singing when you're lonesome, laughing when you're hurt inside, grinning on your own son, giggling when you're lost. Smile at the abyss of winter's grin upon your face, at your wretchedness.
There's just one thing I'm thinking that might just pull this round. It's been quite disappointing, but I've heard a joyous sound. It's coming from the entrance. It's been coming and then going. I think we have a special guest. I think we have Clive Owen. Come on. Come on, you bastard. Shit, otherwise.
I don't think he does live in Spawn, Trevor.
They all go, they all go away.
Dancing when you're sick, singing when you're lonesome, laughing when you're hurt inside, grinning on your own song, giggling when you're lost. Smile at the abyss, a Richter's grin upon your face, at your wretchedness.
Where are we tomorrow?
We're in Luton.
And the day after that?
Rutherfordville.
Dancing when you're sick, singing when you're lonesome, laughing when you're hurt inside, grinning on your own song, giggling when you're lost. Smile at the abyss of winter's grin upon your face, at your wretchedness.
Thank you, Coventry. You were brilliant. Merry Christmas and good night.
Merry Christmas, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much.